you've spent some time aimlessly scrolling Netflix recently, then I'm sure you've come across the posters for the films The Kissing Booth and The Kissing Booth 2. The image on each poster is of a young teenage girl standing in front of two strapping gentlemen with some sort of West Coast palm tree scene in the background. They look harmless, but 10 minutes in, I was really hating myself for even clicking on it. Because let's face it, these movies are bad. They're just bad. So today on Watch Woman, I want to discuss why the Kissing Booth franchise is so popular on one side, yet so critically slammed on the other. When I started digging into how these films came to be, I discovered that they were written by a UK YA author by the name of Beth Reekles. She wrote The Kissing Booth on the popular site called Wattpad. I felt so out of the loop when I looked up Wattpad. It's this whole site where people, mostly young people, can share their stories and build up an audience. Wattpad also advertises their ability to connect authors with media companies and publishers, which obviously was the case with Beth's story. After I discovered that she was 15 when she wrote the first book, a lot of the problems I had story-wise made a lot more sense. But what I couldn't understand is how a book written by a teen girl got in the hands of an almost 50-year-old man to adapt and direct. Personally, that doesn't feel like a good fit, and I don't think that I'm alone in saying that. The first film starts off with a very expository montage, setting up the friendship between Elle, played by Joey King, and Lee, played by Joel Courtney. They tell you everything about these characters, from their birth until present day, where they're now in high school. Their mothers were best friends, they were born on the same day, they share a love for Dance Dance Revolution, and they have rules about their friendship, the main one being rule number 9. Lee's hot older brother, played by Jacob Elordi, is off limits. And rule number 10, never break rule number 9. So obviously this becomes the conflict. But the overall plot isn't what I had a problem with. As they say, the devil is in the details. And the details here are unfortunately outdated, misogynistic, and a total waste of these actors' talents. The Kissing Booth, which was released in 2018, was, at the time, one of the most watched movies in the country and maybe in the world, according to Netflix chief content officer Ted Sarandos. He didn't offer specific numbers, but according to IMDb, at that time, The Kissing Booth was the fourth most popular movie in the United States, behind only Deadpool 2, Avengers Infinity War, and Solo. Some say the film got so popular because there was simply a lack of teen rom-coms streaming at the time. But it also doesn't hurt that the story was so popular amongst teens on the Wattpad site. Proof that teens have a lot of power, even though these films are bad, the audience was already there. To dive a little bit more into those devilish details, let's talk about outdated. I honestly could have been told that this film was from 2006 before I watched it, and I would have absolutely believed it. It has all the makings of a She's the Man or 10 Things I Hate About You. All three films have clumsy protagonists, sexy abs, hello Channing Tatum, and strong actors. The difference is the rescue factor, the White Knight, the Prince Charming, the good old-fashioned damsel in distress rescue mission. It's done well in She's the Man and 10 Things I Hate About You. Each film puts their own spin on it, and some of the time it's the female character rescuing the clueless male character. In today's film and TV landscape, you would be hard-pressed to find a lead female character who's letting a man control her. But Elle's character is being constantly put in embarrassing situations that her male counterparts have to then rescue her from. For example, there's this one scene where she rips her pants right before the first day of school. After she panics a little bit, she realizes she doesn't have a single other pair of pants to put on. Not one pair. She ends up putting on a teeny tiny skirt that she says fit her when she was 12. The skirt is so short you can see her underwear. And she wears that to school. She wouldn't think to tie a jacket around her waist or something. I mean, come on. When she shows up at school, an older boy assaults her by slapping her bottom. But don't worry, because here comes the hot older brother to the rescue. He comes out of nowhere and just starts beating this guy up, and she keeps saying, stop, stop, I can handle myself, but of course he doesn't listen to her. Which brings me to my next point of misogyny. When Elle goes to the principal's office, the principal gives her the same punishment as he did the guy who assaulted her. Does that make any sense? And Elle doesn't seem to be that upset by it, and both movies are like this. Noah fighting people in her honor, and then Lee trying to control her and tell her what she can and cannot do. When Lee finds out about her and Noah sneaking around, oh yeah, spoiler alert, she breaks her friendship rule with Lee and ends up dating Noah. So when Lee finds out, he won't even talk to her. She is just cast out of their friendship. They made these rules when they were like 11. Things change, Lee. Hormones happen to teenagers. Hello, look at the kids in Dawson's Creek. It's also Elle who has to be the bigger person in order to put their friendship back together. It's total bullshit. I also want to point out that the screenplay calls for Elle to always be in situations where she has to take her clothes off. She's caught in a situation where she gets wet, or gets drunk, or there's a beach party. It gets ridiculous after a while. And of course, Noah doesn't like that when she is in these situations because he doesn't want her showing off her body to anyone but him. Once again, how is this appropriate for an almost 50-year-old man to be directing? Joey King is an EP on the second movie, and there were far less scenes of her taking her clothes off. I am all about women owning their sexuality, especially in film and TV. But I felt like the first movie did it in a very unnecessary way. And then when they did do it, they didn't let Elle own it. Instead, they sent in reinforcements in the form of a jealous boyfriend. Not cool, production team, not cool. Now, I've spent a lot of time on the first film, so let's chat about the sequel for a bit. It's just as bad. Maybe slightly better. No, it's just as bad. The cliffhanger of the first film is that Noah is going to Harvard, and Elle is left behind to finish high school. So will their love survive? Oh yeah, that's another thing. Noah gets in to Harvard, yet they never tell us how he got in. It just looks like he's attractive and rich and poof, got in. Besides making out with Elle and starting fights, there is no development for the Noah character at all. It takes the phrase suspension of disbelief to a whole new level. Okay, back to the sequel. The plot moves away from will Elle and Noah work out long distance to will Elle have enough money to go to Harvard to be with Noah. But she also promised Lee that they would go to Berkeley together, so she decides to apply to both schools. But she ain't got no money. Enter a Dance Dance Revolution competition. Naturally, where she could win $50,000. Her and Lee start choreographing their dance, but Lee drops out because, for one, his girlfriend, Rachel, thinks that Elle is hanging around way too much. And she's not wrong. And secondly, he thinks another partner will give her a better chance of winning. That new partner happens to be another hunk with six-pack abs named Marco. Naturally, Marco falls for Elle, and Elle confides in him that she's not sure Noah is being 100% faithful to her while he's all the way away at Harvard. Another spoiler alert, he's not cheating, but the writers do a horrible job of trying to convince the audience that he is. Marco and Elle share a kiss after their big Dance Dance performance on a ridiculous stage straight out of The Hunger Games. Noah sees the kiss from the audience. He was there to surprise her. Oopsie. But don't worry, everything gets wrapped up in a nice little bow in the last 10 minutes of the movie. Elle and Noah get back together and she gets into both schools. Uh-oh, I smell another cliffhanger. What will she do? Go to Harvard and break another stupid rule she has with Lee, or go to Berkeley and have to do long distance with Noah. It's a real nail biter. Sadly, I will probably watch it because, well, I'm bored and apparently a masochist. This whole time I failed to tell you why the films are called The Kissing Booth. And it's a super easy thing to explain. Elle and Lee are a part of the dance team, and they need a fundraiser idea for the annual school fair. So they come up with a kissing booth. And it's there that Elle kisses Noah for the first time. Blindfolded, of course. And also where Lee kisses Rachel for the first time, and they end up together too. So you're telling me all it takes to find true love is to blindfold yourself and make out with someone for a few minutes? Did I mention a 15-year-old wrote this book? Above all else, my biggest disappointment with these films is that Joey King and Jacob Elordi would even do them in the first place. Joey King has been around in the acting game for a long time. I first saw her on an episode of HBO's Entourage where she played Chuck Liddell's daughter. She was also in the first Conjuring film. She played Colin Hanks's daughter in FX's Fargo and most recently got nominated for her role as Gypsy Rose in Hulu's The Act. I think she's extremely talented, and her acting, along with her chemistry with Elordi, saved The Kissing Booth from being even worse than it was. Jacob Elordi is another case. He was relatively unknown before this franchise, but has since turned out a stellar performance on HBO's Euphoria. Once again, he plays an angry and jealous boyfriend type, but the writing is so phenomenal. It gives him a chance to display all of his acting chops. And I have to spill the tea, as the kids say. You might already know this, but Joey King and Jacob Elordi got romantically involved after filming the first Kissing Booth movie, but they eventually split. But they still had to do the second and third films together. Could you imagine making out with your ex day in and day out on camera? It sounds terrible. Joey King has gone on to say that she will never date an actor again after Jacob. It's just too hard to be on the same career path, she says. Kudos to both of them for keeping it professional and getting through back-to-back shoots. Joey King is actually rumored to be dating one of her producers from The Act, Steven Paeth, and Jacob has been with Euphoria co-star Zendaya since February. Lastly, just for fun, I want to read a couple audience comments from the popular website Letterboxd. These folks say things a little better than I could. Take note, all these people gave The Kissing Booth and The Kissing Booth 2 a half star. Let's start with Vex saying, why was there so many panty shots by a director who's primarily done, quote, checks IMDb, American Girl movies? My point exactly, Vex. Moving on to Is This Julia saying, L, just get a part-time job instead of wasting all of your money on an arcade machine. I hate everyone in this movie. Mad Mao with a half star saying, fuck this movie, just watch Edge of 17. I second that, Mad Mao. Xchell underscore LG, one long TikTok. And my favorite comment by A underscore L underscore B underscore I, a simple Y period. I love the internet sometimes. Now it's time for my favorite part. I think you guys can probably guess my rating for these films. I'm going to give both The Kissing Booth and The Kissing Booth 2 one Funfetti cupcake out of 5. Can't wait to hate watch The Kissing Booth 3 coming to Netflix sometime in 2021. That's it for this episode of Watch Woman. What did you guys think of the Kissing Booth franchise? Leave your comments below, click the subscribe button on your screen, and I will see you back here in 2 weeks for a brand new episode. See ya.